Welcome to Discovery Watch with John Kaiser.
I'm your host, Jim Goddard. Welcome back to the show, John.
Jim, pleasure to be back on the show.
John, Forum Energy has been under selling pressure since last Friday. Is the uranium bubble already finished?
Oh, no. The uranium bubble still has a ways to go. Its uranium price is still in the $40, $50 per pound range. Well, it needs to be above $60 and stabilize above that level for new uranium production to be worth putting into production. So we're still in the early stages of the uranium bubble. Now, Forum Energy put out some news on Friday that really had nothing to do with uranium. It had to do with the Janus Lake project. And what they said was that Rio Tinto had spent $14 million, which is more than the $10 million needed to vest for 51%. But the key thing in the news release was that they did not plan a budget for 2022. Now, what that means is that Rio Tinto's work that it's done so far has not really supported the idea that there's a 500 million ton plus copper silver sediment hosted system present at the Janus Lake project within that 52 kilometer long basin that they auctioned in 2018 from Forum Energy. Most of the drilling that they've done, or all of it in fact, has been done in the central portion of this basin, but they have done geophysical surveys and mapping and prospecting well beyond that central area. But the refuse drilling that they did in the winter and then this summer, it just hasn't delivered the grades and width combinations that allows them to see that their tonnage threshold is happening. Now, various media outlets misunderstood this press release and said, oh, Rio Tinto now owns 51% of this project. Well, that's not really the case. Rio Tinto, in order to vest for 51%, needs to give notice to a Forum Energy that it has spent this money and earned 51%. And it must make a $100,000 payment in May of next year. And it doesn't really have to make an election to go to 80% until May of 2023. So the negative market reaction was, oh, Rio Tinto will probably own 51%. They're going to sit on this property for 2 years and then maybe decide to just do a 51-49 JV and just obliterate the poor junior as it meets the cash calls on a program whose budget and timing and disclosures are driven by big company policies. So therefore, Janus Lake is effectively dead. So that, of course, that news came out on Friday when the market took a big dive, when the news of the Omicron variant surfaced, and the market said, uh-oh, here we go again, another major lockdown, a hit to the economy. But then on Monday, the stock took another hit. And that was because the Uranium Insider, which had put out a sell recommendation a month or so ago after it changed its mind about its exposure to uranium type plays and decided that they really only want pound in the ground optionality plays, you know, exposure to projects that are essentially worthless at the current uranium price, even though it's double what it was a year or two ago. They did not want exposure to expiration. And they also were concerned that the intersections that were published for the Rafus project at Janus Lake weren't really signaling that anything was going to be happening with this project. However, what they had only done was put out sell half. Now, sometimes you put out a sell half recommendation when you've got a great stock pick, the stock has gone up, and now it keeps going up, and it's kind of in la-la land in terms of valuation, but because you have no idea when this will stop, they'll advise your followers, maybe take money off the table, sell half. The story's still intact, the valuation is more than fair, so, you know, take your profits, we've done well so far. However, when you change the reason for liking it in the first place, then when you put out sell half, that's kind of a flaky thing to do because any of your followers who have a brain are going to say, oh, the story's changed. I'm going to sell all of it. And that's what that hit was all about. When the Janus Lake news came out, the Uranium Insider decided that, oh, there might be some of my followers who are not very bright, so I will tell them to sell everything in Forum Energy. So you had another wave of selling that obviously goes beyond just the followers of the Uranium Insider, but spreads around the market. But the and this, of course, has created a great bottom fishing opportunity for Forum Energy, which the writing was already on in the wall a couple of months ago that Janus Lake just wasn't delivering the grade and widths of intersections needed to make this a world-class play. And the company had started to pivot to its uranium portfolio, where it had spent, and its partners had spent over $30 million from 2004 to 2015. The only bad news was that the Fur Island project, which is farmed out to Orano, they weren't going to drill this winter because they wanted to do a resistivity survey. They didn't get everything done this winter because we had such a warm winter up in the north that the ice never got thick enough to support the drill rig. And so they're going to use the winter ice from the first quarter of next year to do these extra data collection and then drill it in the first quarter of 2023, which is like an eternity for your typical resource junior shareholder. However, Forum Energy is planning to drill its Wollaston project, which is to the east of the McLean Mill. And we talked about this a few sessions ago. So there's a chance for a discovery happening there. But it's really its exposure to this portfolio of 10 or so projects that it still owns in the Athabasca Basin. The uranium bubble is still intact. It's in terms of the metal price, it hasn't really bubbled to the level where it needs to be. But for exploration plays, it's now becoming interesting, especially in the Athabasca Basin, where you can make very high-grade discoveries. And, of course, they're going to take 5 to 7 years to fully flesh out with an economic study and have it ready for the permitting cycle. And it's pretty much the end of this decade before any real new demand beyond existing supply capacity kicks in. So in my view, sitting on these optionality plays and praying that the Sprott Uranium Trust can pump the uranium price up into the $60-$80 range and keep it there, that's not very interesting, but exploration plays interest me. But with regard to Janus Lake, the more likely scenario that we're going to see, rather than Rio Tinto sitting on it for 2 years doing nothing, they had a very good year this year with iron prices. They spent $14 million. This project clearly doesn't need its threshold, so it could use a $14 million write-off. Right now, it has to capitalize the expense. And does it really want to make a $100,000 payment next May, throwing more good money after bad? And does it really want to keep this land tied up that a junior might continue to explore for a smaller-scale outcome and piss off the Saskatchewan government and the whole, Canadian establishment, just tie up this land and have nothing to do it because there's some bean counter hyper-optimization logic that says you must keep all these things for yourself and not just walk away from it? I have a suspicion that Rio Tinto will walk away from this project, hand it back 100% to Forum Energy, and of course the project has the hit that it doesn't appear to have Udelkan potential. But there's $14 million of work done on it, a lot of it in that central area with the Jan target and the refuse target. So there's room for Forum Energy to go back in there and look at these areas where the drilling was done and stitch together a smaller system while studying the data that Rio Tinto generated for the entire basin. And maybe another partner will come along that doesn't need quite such a world-class outcome, but that would like to develop a sediment-hosted copper-silver system in northern Saskatchewan. So no, nothing to do with the uranium bubble fizzing. We are in a very difficult period right now. It's year-end. The first quarter of 2021 was good for the juniors, but since April, it has been an awful year. And in the past few weeks, we have seen almost all stocks turn negative, trend down. There's big fear that the general equity markets are finally going to have their comeuppance and retreat 10, 15, maybe 20%. So we're getting an excellent bottom fishing season, and Forum Energy down here at that 15 cents to 20 cent range, that's where it becomes very interesting as a bottom fish, and its uranium story is now its flagship story. And we're still waiting for the Love Lake nickel copper platinum group results. I'm not holding my breath on that, but since you can't tell what's in these in this core until you have assays, and assay labs are so backed up, it might even be January before we hear it. Right now, I look at Forum Energy as a uranium exploration junior focused on the Athabasca Basin, with perhaps, and very soon, getting back 100% control of the Janus Lake copper silver play.
We'll have more with John Kaiser right after this.
Media recognition from Bloomberg, Reuters, recycling trade publications. Patented process for 100% recovery of critical metals, including cobalt, lithium, nickel, manganese, aluminum. American Manganese is focused on recycling lithium-ion batteries for electric vehicles. American Manganese trades on the TSX Venture, AMY, the U.S., AMYZF, and Frankfurt 2AM. For more information, visit AmericanManganeseInc.com or phone me, Larry Ray, at 778-574-4444.
Welcome back. We're speaking with John Kaiser. John, you're very busy these days with bottom fish research. Does one of your favorites called Vanstar Mining qualify as a bottom fish?
Well, Vanstar Mining was supposed to be a fair spec valuated favorite, and that's what it still is. But as I'm heading into the new year, I'm changing my whole model as Kaiser Research Online. I'll be shifting to more a do-it-yourself research platform, which at some point next year will end up costing new members substantially more than the current $450 per year price. We cover all the Canadian and Australian listed companies. We've got a very powerful search engine, which I'm using now to hunt down bottom fish candidates. And anybody who's still a member, when we do the switch sometime early next year, they'll be able to renew at the old $450 price, grandfathered indefinitely, so long as they maintain a continuous membership. But we're shifting away from trying to sell a newsletter to a sort of a retail audience, because it's really, frankly, in the resource sector, unless we have a raging gold price, it's really tough to be consistently good as a stock picker. It's much better to offer a platform, a research platform for family offices, hedge funds, very high net worth individuals who don't really care what I have to say about particular companies, but who use the research tools, all the information we have in the profiles, to save themselves a lot of time while they track down their own picks based on whatever they, you know, assumptions they have about how the future will unfold. Now, that said, I will continue to operate a bottom fish type workshop. It's sort of an incubator where I flag companies that are bottom fish, or ones that have a missing piece of some sort, which is at the moment preventing them from, you know, taking off and going through a speculation cycle. I'll also have a KRO watch list for more advanced companies that aren't crawling along a bottom or descending into a bottom. And the idea is, I will discuss all these companies, point them out through our Slack forum. We engage in interactive discussions about the pros and cons of different strategies. But when a company ceases to be a bottom fish for positive reasons, such as achieving escape velocity, the missing pieces are in place, the story's unfolding, the discovery's in place, or they've got an economic study out that the market is very happy with, and the effective metal is trending higher, and the stock is maybe double, tripled from its bottom, then we will graduate it from the bottom fish shop as a public favorite. So instead of selling favorite picks to my paying audience, I will run this bottom fish workshop and assist people in assembling, you know, not directly but indirectly, assembling a portfolio of bottom fish. And when these things start to flourish, then we'll release them as a public favorite. And an obvious candidate is Verde Agritech. Right now, it's one of the few stocks that's trending up rather than trending down. And that's because its story is has reached a tipping point. The company is finally getting its product adopted by the Brazilian farmers thanks to the potash crisis that's on. And that is the kind of company that I would, in the new year, introduce as a free favorite so that the Twitter following that I have, when I publish something, it'll be available to them. I can tweet the link to them, and they can check it out and follow the favorites in that manner. So with back to your question about bottom fishing, yeah, I'm super busy right now. I've just gone through and all the existing bottom fish, which, of course, unfortunately, are still bottom fish. That isn't exactly a great thing because that means they really didn't do anything all year since they were flagged a year ago. But we're also seeing all kinds of stocks that would never have been considered as bottom fish descending into the bottom fish range. And that's because we are now in a brutal tax loss selling season. Companies that have money in the treasury, who are still awaiting assays, probably won't arrive until the first quarter of next year. All of them are descending, some just because shareholders are despairing that we're ever going to get back into a proper bull cycle. Others because they bought higher when it was financed and are just collecting their losses so that they can offset some of the profits they made on stocks they sold in the first quarter. And Vanstar is one of those that has descended into a bottom. And the story is their 20% carried interest in the Nelligan project, 3.2 million ounces of about 1 gram per ton. IAM Gold is the operator. It effectively owns 80%. The stock, however, is in the doldrums because the market does not have a sense for the timing of when IAM Gold will want to accelerate this project through an economic study, do a PEA, then start doing a pre-feasibility study, and eventually want to buy out Vanstar. But this week we had a very positive development, which makes Vanstar one of the higher priority stocks. Now, one of the things as you head into the new year is that if you want to buy a bottom fish in December, you don't want to buy one that's been flatlining all year and doesn't have any reason to take off in January. What you want is a bottom fish where there is a story that management, whose unfolding management can drive and promote and attract eyeballs to, and whose results can change the fundamental value of the company. Now, if Vanstar were to just sit there and do nothing for several years, its 20% interest based on an outcome visualization would end up being worth $3 plus a share. But until it is clear that IAM Gold is fast-tracking this project, who knows how long it will take for such a target to be reached. But this week, Vanstar announced a deal that allows it to earn 75% of the Calder Bousquet project from IAM Gold by spending $4 million over 4 years. And after it's done that, IAM Gold will have the right to back in for a net 50% interest by spending four times that much. Now, what's interesting about this deal is Calder Bousquet is only about 3-4 kilometers southwest of the Westwood mill, which right now has a capacity problem because it's run out of ore or running out of ore from its own deposit. And the Doyon deposit had an earthquake last year or a seismic event. That means it's not really producing. So this is an underutilized mill, and it's mainly for underground ore. And IAM Gold would like to feed more ore to that. And it's working on Yorboza Rouyn-Noranda project as a potential future feed. And it's also got another project to the north where it's looking at making a small open pit and trucking that ore down to the mill. So you ask, why is it giving this project to Vanstar on relatively easy terms? Well, the property has been Swiss cheese down to several hundred meters. And IAM Gold did some of it. It was looking for some low-hanging fruit in the form of open pitable ore. It just doesn't hang together sufficiently to do this. So it has given this project or optioned this project to Vanstar to let it poke some deep holes in there to see if at depth this orogenic vein system blossoms and gets bigger widths. And of course, some of the Vanstar people are involved with Amex, which has turned its Perron project, which was also this project that for decades really never yielded anything, even while Agnico Eagle had it under option. Then finally, they scored into a high-grade zone and now have a huge program going and are going outlining a major high-grade gold system deeper than was previously understood by the past exploration. So this allows Vanstar to take some of that $5 million that it has in the treasury and start spending it drilling this deeper potential. And should it start to hit something, well, then it has 50% net. It's the sort of project that IAMGOLD would become very interested in and fast-track. It doesn't really have an exploration budget for this sort of thing, so letting Vanstar, which it eventually needs to own, go spend the money, get its stock price up higher, and set the stage for a future buyout. And then you say, whoa, why would IAMGOLD help Vanstar? Well, at the 40-cent price, nobody would tender to an IAMGOLD offer, and IAMGOLD might be able to offer 80 cents a share, but not more than that, because in the gold sector, your own shareholders will punish you if you offer too much of a premium over the market price. So IAMGOLD actually needs Vanstar to have a higher valuation, but because it seems to be moving so slowly on advancing Nelligan, the stock's stuck in a rut, and they don't have Peter Grandage there promoting it to his followers and talking about how gold's going to go to the moon and drag this along with it. It needs to have a story that it controls that allows it to achieve a higher valuation during the interim. Now, what's happening with Nelligan? They finished the infill drilling on the Renard zone, and that's going to support a resource update. That's not going to make it bigger. That's only going to change it from inferred into the indicated category. But they also did drilling on the west extension, and they don't expect those results until the first quarter of next year. And the west extension is where there's potential to increase the deposit significantly. And IAMGOLD doesn't really publish many details while it's doing a program. We don't know how far west it did drill. And there's maybe 7 kilometers of strike that it can chase. But it has done work about 700 meters west of the existing resource. There may not yet be the density to allow them to include what's there in the Nelligan update, which is why they are planning a follow-up drill program in January, a winter program, and that is most likely designed to stitch together greater density holes so that when they do the updated resource estimate, they not only shift Nelligan inferred resources into the indicated category, but they also add some inferred resources from the west, and it would be nice to see this deposit go from sort of 2 million ounces up into the, 2.9 million ounces up into the 4 million plus ounce. And then we want to hear what the drilling is farther west. What did the wider spaced holes intersect? Is there a case to go in there with the summer program and really drill this off so that by early 2023, IAMGOLD has found the limits of this, the open pittable portion of this system, and is ready to go into economic study mode and maybe produce a PEA in the second half of 2023. And that would be the time when they could move with a friendly offer to buy out Vanstar. In the meantime, Vanstar makes for a great bottom fish that could likely take off in the new year because it will be controlling the Calder Bousquet drilling that's in the Cadillac Larder Break portion of between Rouyn-Noranda and Malartic in Quebec. So excellent bottom fishing season right now, super busy. Vanstar is one I've already flagged as what I might call a favorite among bottom fish.
John, thank you so much for the update.
You're welcome.
We've been talking with John Kaiser, his website kaiserresearch.com. I'm Jim Goddard.
Comments made on Discovery Watch are an expression of opinion only and should not be construed in any manner whatsoever as recommendations to buy or sell any financial instrument at any time. Archived online at HowStreet.com. Discovery Watch is a production of How Street Media Incorporated.